Welcome to the Wild Neighbor Speaker Series. We're happy to have you. My name is Jaya Torres with Austin Water Wildland Conservation. This series is a collaboration with Travis County Natural Resources, who co-manages the BCP with us. Don't forget to put any questions that you may have in the Q&A box, and we'll address them after the presentation. Today, we're happy to have a City of Austin Balcones Canyonlands Preserve biologist, Colin Strickland. Colin is a second-generation caver who works at the City of Austin's BCP as a cave biologist. One of his main goals is to shed light on Central Texas cave organisms through photography and videography. Colin, I'll hand it over to you.
Hey, everybody. I'm Colin Strickland. I'm a biologist at the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve. I actually deal with cave biology. And today I'm going to take you kind of on a journey starting at the entrance of a cave and going into the cave and seeing what we see along the way as we get deeper into the cave. So let me share my presentation. All right. Central Texas cave life. So many of y'all probably know the Balcones Canyonland Preserves. Canyonlands Preserve is in western Travis County. It's a large preserve that was put in place to protect 8 endangered species and 27 species of concern. Most people have heard about golden-cheeked warbler and the black-capped vireo, but most people don't know that almost all of those other species are karst invertebrates. So of the species of concern, there's 2 plants and 25 other karst invertebrates, and then there's 6 endangered karst invertebrates. So basically almost the entire preserve is for karst invertebrates, but no one's ever heard of any of them. So I'm gonna show y'all some of this. So one of the first things you'll notice when you approach a cave is the plant life is a little bit different around the entrance. You'll start to see things like ferns and moss and everything inside the entrance of the cave. That's because there's not so much sun and all the moisture and everything can remain. And so this provides interesting habitat for plants that couldn't survive on the surface and can only handle this moisture condition. And also you'll start to see other organisms that don't fare too well in Texas summers, but they do fine in this humid cave environment. So this is a little land snail that you'll see them around Austin on like a rainy day, but most of the time they gotta hide under logs and stuff just to stay moist enough. But in the caves, it's near 100% humidity, so they can just cruise around doing their thing all the time. So organisms like this that like to live in caves but don't really have to are called troglophiles. So these guys, from the Greek troglos for cave and philia for love, troglophiles are the cave lovers. So basically, they can survive on the surface, but they also really like the moist, cool conditions inside the cave. So some of these include the Gulf Coast toad. You'll find these near the entrance of caves a lot of times. You find land snails like this guy. So like, I videoed this in like the middle of summer in August a few years ago when it hadn't rained in over a month. Yet this guy was just cruising along. And then everybody loves these western slimy salamanders. These guys hang out in the cave and eat all sorts of karst invertebrates. Sometimes they come out when it rains and move around, but they can survive in the cave for a long time. They can actually get pretty big. I read online that they can get up to 8 inches long. The biggest I've ever seen is maybe a 7-incher, but they're pretty cool. And they're basically like apex predator down in the cave ecosystem. They eat all the little karst invertebrates. So you can see he's about to eat a springtail. And then he eats another karst invertebrates. And I first turned my light on, I got really annoyed. But then I decided, hey, I can see that I eat now. It's much easier than anything. Also, I sometimes wondered as you can see here, sometimes the food just comes straight to them. They don't have to do anything. Just put it in their mouth and eat it like that little cricket nymph. But yeah, he's on the lookout now. On the left, you'll see a little springtail. In a second, and he starts eyeing it. But this springtail is really lucky. He ends up going right underneath his chin before he could get him. But there's a little mite in the foreground who is not so lucky. It ends up becoming dinner. It's pretty cool stuff. I've never actually seen these guys eating before, so pretty interesting. So the next group I'm going to tell you about are the troglodytes. From the Greek troglos for cave and xenos for guest, troglodytes are the part-time cave dwellers. So most of y'all will probably think about bats. And yeah, we've got Mexican free-tailed bats, but most of our caves are pretty small around here. And so we tend to find just a small groups of these tricolored bats, maybe, I don't know, less than 10 generally. They're known as Perimyotis subflavus. So troglodytes are really important because the cave ecosystem has almost no nutrients due to the fact that there's no photosynthesis going on. The only nutrients that come in are what is like washed into the cave or what is brought in by organisms such as bats and other troglodytes. Another troglodyte you'll see at the entrance of caves in great numbers are Leobundinum townsendii, the standard daddy long legs. These guys form these huge mats, people call beards sometimes, and they can be in the many thousands, but they don't bite or anything. I just have a hard time trying to climb out of the cave without squishing them. Sometimes I just have to sit there for a long time and let them get out of the way. One of my favorite troglodytes are these super adorable cliff chirping frogs. So these are some pretty small little frogs. They hang out in the cave during the day, and at nighttime they climb out of the cave and look for food in the forest. They have this really cool technique where they sit in these little holes in the walls and sing, and the hole amplifies their voice so they can find mates over a farther distance. And they're also really good climbers. They can pretty much climb up any surface, even like inverted surfaces and stuff. So you don't normally think you'll find frogs in Texas up on top of a plateau, but these guys are nice and moist down in their caves. So some other troglodytes are the mammals. My coworker Drew Thompson set up this game camera a couple years back, and I pieced together this video of all the critters coming out of Slaughter Creek Cave. So there's raccoons that live in there. Standard possums. And we got porcupines now. Porcupines seem to have moved in the last, I don't know, 10 to 15 years. They weren't as prevalent back in the day, but now they're here. So yeah, all these mammals, they're pretty wary of predators because with so much mammal activity, there's a lot of mammal smell and it attracts predators. This porcupine's so skittish when the wind blows, he jumps. He's kind of freaked out, but he has good reason to be wary because there's a lot of predators that check out the cave entrance. So here you got a gray fox checking it out, smelling all those raccoons and possums. You have the whole pack of coyotes. And even a bobcat. So pretty cool. There's a lot of activity. I've started putting a lot of game camera at the entrances of caves, both inside and out, to see all this action going on. And recently, I got to catch a ringtail. So we don't see these very often because they're super shy. But I had a game camera set up. You can see this one. It's kind of eating. Yeah, apparently these guys will sit outside the cave and wait. And all the cave crickets come out around sunset, and it can be like they can get a little bit of a cricket. And then they'll get a bit like and 14 years. This guy's crickets fell down the pool. They're not distracting the world. This was on the video a couple weeks ago, and I got that camera still set up, so hopefully that guy's going to come back some more. So all these mammals coming in and out of the cave are providing a lot of nutrients. So on the left, you can see a lot of times their scat has seeds in it, which will sprout, and then the plants will rot, and that will help feed bacteria and fungus. And on the right here, you can see porcupine scat. And for some reason, the porcupine scat always has this distinctive white mushrooms on them, which I call porcupine mushrooms, but I would like to figure out what they actually are. But due to the small size of most of our caves around here, we don't generally have super big caves with like large bat colonies. Most of them are pretty small and crawly. So the most important troglodyte in Central Texas is the Texas cave cricket. These guys can be found in large numbers in some caves with many hundreds of thousands of them roosting on the ceiling. So when you have this many crickets together, not only do they provide food to predators, but also they basically rain cricket scat onto the floor, producing a really nice layer of cricket guano, which then provides nutrients for fungus and bacteria, which then feed other organisms. So yeah, everybody loves tasty cave crickets. On the left here, you can see this eyeless cave spider, Sicarina, eating a cricket nymph that it caught. On the right here, you can see this this scorpion, a cave scorpion, Pseudoarachnidus rudelli. He's ripped off an entire cricket's leg and he's chewing on it. And here you can see this plethodon salamander tried to eat this cricket whole. He ended up spitting it out because he thought I was trying to eat him, which I felt really bad about. But yeah, all this cricket guano rains down, making a nice manure for bacteria and fungus, which is then fed on by these tiny springtails, Pseudocinella violenta. So these guys are super important because they basically form the base of the food chain and everything else eats them. As you can see, in this cricket guano covered floor, there are extremely large numbers of these springtails. Yeah, you can see all the fungal mycelia growing off the cricket guano. But yeah, these little springtails provide a prey for pseudoscorpions and spiders. Some other organisms that benefit from all the nutrients in the guano are these eyeless cave millipedes, Cambalus spiobia, and these eyeless land snails, Helicodiscus eigenmanni. So yeah, It's interesting, these Cambula millipedes, they're blind, but they have some sort of light sensing organ, because when you shine a light on them, they curl up in a little spiral, but after like a minute or so, they uncurl and start cruising around, so I'm able to get photos and video. These little land snails, Helicobiscus, they're pretty easy. You can just think of like a flat biscuit. They are eyeless. Well, they have eyes, but they don't work anymore. So they're blind, and then they just sense chemicals in the air with their four tentacles to find food and mates and whatever. So once you get really deep into the cave, you get the troglobites, which are what I think are the coolest organisms. So from the Greek troglos for cave and bio for life, the troglobites spend their entire lives in caves and cannot survive on the surface. So troglobites are relegated to like deeper in the cave where temperatures remain constant. And in central Texas, it usually remains about 72 degrees year round. And then humidity is near 100%. So this here is Texella mulaike. It is a harvest men, so basically like a daddy long leg, but this one's pretty tiny and it can only live, yeah, super deep in the cave where it's moist all the time. These guys are only found in southern Travis County. Alright, screaming baby in the background. Yeah, these guys are only found in southern Travis County and northern Hays County. They're one of the most looking troglobites, I think. Almost nothing is known about their diet or anything. So due to the nutrient-limited environment, troglobites tend to be small, have slower metabolisms, longer lifespan, and lay fewer eggs than their surface relatives. So that's a Texella mulaike on my coworker Drew Thompson's finger. Other adaptions to life underground include pigmentation, legs and antenna, enhanced tactile, vibratory, and olfactory senses. So you're gonna see like, a lot of these, I have the genus name and then the species is SPP. That's because a lot of these organisms, we have multiple species in the Austin area. And this is due to the fact that there's a lot of geologically isolated areas that have evolved around species. Central Texas has only a dozen species of these Spiodesmus cave millipedes. And then a lot of the other organisms as well are have very localized range distributions. So these Tartar oak rigorous pseudoscorpions, we got about seven species in the Austin area, but some of them are only known from a single cave location. So pretty cool, and we gotta make sure we protect the locations because these guys are very unique. So these guys don't have eyes, but they have sensory hairs all over their body that they use and they just run around with their arms out, and so then when they run into prey, they're able to grab them. Probably the most prolific troglobitic predator are these Sicarina spiders. Pretty much go in a cave and start flipping rocks to find me. But they have no eyes at all, and they just have sensory hairs. You see this one turning his feet, got some big old fangs. You can imagine being a favorite can be back. But this one you can tell he's a male because his front pedipalps are enlarged and look like little boxing gloves. You can see on his head where the eyes would normally be, it's completely smooth and clear because the eyes have been completely eliminated so long underground. So this is one of our Verdiny species. We got three species in the Austin area. So these Verdiny beetles feed on cave cricket eggs, and they've adapted a super elongated head and neck so that they can reach their head into the holes in the sandy or soil or dirt floor where the crickets lay their eggs. It's easier for them to pull out the eggs. So these Passionetta spiders, they're extremely small, first of all. Like, the body length is like 1.5 millimeters, so it's really hard to get photos and videos of them. And what's really cool about them is they're basically see-through, but they reflect blue off of their legs when you shine a light on them. So, pretty cool-looking little creatures. Look like they're made out of glass or something. So these Plexorhodelia, these are cave silverfish. Now these actually get pretty long. I don't know, they're like maybe like two inches long. This one's cleaning his antenna. Since he doesn't have eyes, he's got to keep his antenna nice and clean. You can see one of them got clipped off by, I don't know, cave scorpion or something. This guy's staying still long enough to get some pictures, but normally these guys are just constantly on the move, as you'll see in this next video. So yeah, this is generally how we find Plexorhodelia texensis. It's constantly moving around. That's one of my favorite species names to say. Plexorhodelia texensis. Say that 10 times fast. This one, this is from one of my YouTube videos y'all can check out later. So it actually has like words added. So this eyeless spider, genus Eidmanella, barely escaped the pseudoscorpion, Tartarocoregus infernalis. So yeah, this is gonna be, this pseudoscorpion uses sensory hairs on its bodies and limbs to sense its environment. Its sensory hairs brushed up against the spider before it ran away, so it knows something is close. It slowly waves its pedipalps around, probing for its prey. The spider makes a bad move. With its abdomen in the grasp of the pseudoscorpion's pincer, there's little chance of escape. There are venom glands on the tips of the pincers. The pincer has punctured the abdomen and is injecting venom. You can see a small drop of liquid forming on the spider's abdomen. It's either hemolymph or venom. Now the spider is basically paralyzed. And then he can just chew them up at his leisure. So yeah, it's pretty miraculous how they will capture that. Barely anyone's ever seen that interaction before. So yeah, if you're lucky enough to go deep enough in a cave and you find water, like a stream or a pool, you may get to see some stygobites. So from the Greek stygo for sticks and bio for life, in Greek mythology, the river Styx was the boundary to the underworld. So this is an underground stream, and you can see some aquatic isopods in the genus Cicadodia, as well as some aquatic amphipods in the genus Stygobromus. You can see how crystal clear the water is. There's no algae or anything since it's underground. Here you can see a bunch of Cicadodia feeding on this cricket carcass. And here you can go see Cicadodia and Stygobromus feeding on this bark scorpion that fell into the water and drowned. So the Stygobromids are flattened side to side, look kind of like a little shrimp, while the Cicadodia isopod, they're flattened top to bottom. So this here is a cave planarian, or a flatworm, Phyloplanomori. Basically almost nothing is known about them as far as I can tell. They don't even know what they eat. I mean, try Googling this thing. You'll find like a little drawing outline from like the 60s or something. That's about the extent of our knowledge. So probably need to do some more research on these guys. But they get pretty long, up to about an inch long, which is pretty big flatworm. And yeah, if you're real lucky, you might even get to see salamanders in caves. So this is a Jollyville Plateau salamander. It's a relative of the Barton Springs salamander. We only have these in kind of northwest Travis County, southern Williamson County, up in northwest Austin, and in the Cedar Park area. They live in springs, but also they live in caves that have streams. There's a lot of actually caves with streams up in the Buttercup area of Cedar Park that have these in them. And I'm going to show y'all a few other species that I think are cool in these caves. So this is the Texas cave scorpion, Pseudoarachnus fideli. A lot of times you'll find these guys hanging out in little crevices and cracks near the entrance of a cave, and they wait for the crickets to exit at night, and then they reach out their pincers and grab them. This is Suthophilus cunicularis, a species of cave cricket. So these guys are more compact and kind of bright orange and shiny. Unlike the other cave crickets, these ones rarely, if ever, leave the cave. They just eat whatever they can find inside the cave. This is Suthophilus species B. So it's an undescribed species of cave cricket. It looks somewhat similar to Suthophilus secretus, but as you can see, it doesn't have all the dark patterning on its back, and it has this sort of a peach fuzz look on its lower abdomen. And also, they're adults at different times of the year. So Suthophilus secretus are adults in the summer. So right now, there's like tons of them, while I think these guys are adults in the winter. Some other cool organisms are diplurans. This one's in family Campodiidae. These are super primitive invertebrates. They've been around for a long time. Their antennae look like they're basically made out of little glass beads strung together. And then they have two long sensory circi on the other end of their abdomen to sense their environment. And then these guys are really cool. You don't see them very often. I've been working at the city for almost 4 years, and I've maybe seen three of these. And some of the times these can get really big, up to 3 inches long or bigger. And instead of the two circi on the end of the tail, they have this big pincer that they use to capture and hold their prey while they consume them. And then one of my favorites are these symphylans, which most people, I guess, know about them because they're considered a garden pest. They're not really a cave organism. They're more of a soil-dwelling organism, but we see them in caves all the time. And it's pretty funny. On my YouTube channel, my symphylan video has like the most by far views because everyone's probably trying to figure out how to kill them. And then they find my video and they're like, oh, what the heck? This guy likes these things. So anyhow, you can check them out. They're super cool. Since they don't have eyes or anything, they literally wave their antenna around and taste their environment, trying to find food and mates. I think they're adorable, but apparently some of them feed on roots of plants and stuff, so gardeners don't like them. Another pretty obscure organism that we find in caves, but also just live in soil everywhere, are the microwhip scorpions, or palpagrada. grady. So these guys are extremely small, and they have these weird bottle brush tails. Not much is known about them. A recent study found that some of them eat bacteria, which is pretty interesting, because that would make them one of the few arachnids that doesn't eat animals. And then these guys are really cool. This is family Trichiniscidae. It's a family of soil-dwelling isopods. So these guys are super tiny, and they live in moist soil. So yeah, I normally find these like in moist soil by flipping over rocks. I've been talking to like Ben Hutchins from Texas State about these guys. And basically he says all the species around here are undescribed. So there's some work to be done if we got any taxonomists that want to name some species. Some of these species have eyes while others are completely eyeless. You can see this one here has some rudimentary eyes. But yeah, their antennae are apparently adapted to not only chemosensing, but also humidity sensing. Since these are isopods, they need to stay moist. So their antennae help them sense if they're going into a dry area, and then they'll go back to where it's moister. So yeah, pretty much when I flip the rock over and shine my bright, warm light on them, they don't like that very much, and they tend to fall away pretty quickly. Next. And finally, I'm going to show y'all these globular springtails. So I tend to find these in caves. I didn't really notice them before, but now I've found that if you look at the tiniest little pools of water in caves, you'll find these guys on the pool of water. And we think it may actually be because they're stuck in the middle of the pool. But I'm talking like a pool of water that's like an inch and a half across. And you'll end up with one of these guys sitting right in the middle of it. So these guys are so tiny that they don't even put an indention in the surface of the water at all. It's basically like they're walking on glass. So yeah, these guys get a bad rap, sort of like the symphylums. Now a lot of gardening websites are like, how to get rid of all these terrible infestations of springtails. But basically, these things are good for the environment. They help aerate the soil and everything, and also they just provide food for everything. So don't mess with the springtails. But yeah, that's pretty much the end of our journey.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Colin. That was just some of the just cool. The videos and photographs that you shared are just some of the coolest that I've ever seen of the cave life. A reminder to everyone watching that this video will be recorded and it will be posted to both the Travis County and City of Austin YouTube pages and along with Facebook. So if you missed any parts of this or want to go back and watch other parts, you'll be able to do that, share it with your friends. And then if you have any additional questions for Colin, go ahead and start throwing them in the Q&A and we will get to as many of them as we can. We do have a couple questions already, Colin, so I'll just read them off and we can just go through them from there. One of the volunteers that helps us with cave cricket counts often asked, do you know what the common species of mice are that we always see running around the cave entrances?
I can't remember the exact species name, but yeah, it's a species of deer mouse. I'll have to get back to them about the exact species. I have it written down somewhere, but yeah.
Yeah, we have a lot of white-footed deer mouse. Is that some?
I'm not sure, yeah. I just know the species name that I have in my lists of creatures. But yeah, they're pretty funny. A lot of times they'll poke their head out, and as long as you're staying like super still, they're very curious, and they'll walk right up to within like 2 feet of your face to look at you before they go, oh no, human, and then run back in the cave. So
that's awesome. Okay, another question is, would the cave crickets in our caves survive without the caves as a place to go during the day, or would this species decline?
It's hard to say. I mean, they definitely like being in the caves, but the cave crickets can live, you know, under houses and just like under logs and stuff. I guess if it was like super drought conditions, they might run into trouble, but you can find them just like on my property here. I'm too low for there to be, I'm in the wrong geology, so there's no caves, but we have a lot of piles of logs with tarps over it, and sometimes when I'm digging through there I find cave crickets under them. So probably there would be a lot less numbers without the caves, but they can definitely survive in some surface habitat.
Okay, this next question is a little bit of the chicken or the egg conundrum here, but they said, it seems like many of the strictly cave dwellers are morphologically similar to the species above ground. So did the species, which species evolved from which? Did we get the cave species from the ground dwellers or the ground dwellers from the cave species?
So basically the theory on how all these troglodytes came about was a long time ago, millions of years ago, it was a lot moister in Central Texas. And all of these species ancestors were surface or soil dwelling organisms. But as the climate changed, and then also there was the geology in this area, there being all this open space underground, a lot of these organisms just slowly adapted to move farther and farther underground, and to the point where many of them became so adapted that they could no longer survive on the surface, thus becoming troglobites. But one of the problems when you become a troglobite is you can't go up to the surface and move over to another area. And so in Central Texas, since we have so much faulting and everything and uplift and displacement, a lot of the limestone areas are discontiguous. And so you end up with, originally, these species were probably just a few species got pushed, that slowly adapted to go underground, but then the geology shifted and they all became little isolated islands, basically like island biogeography, where you have these karst islands that are separated by downcut river valleys and canyons, as well as just like uplifts and shifting of the geology where the limestone layers no longer line up. And then that's how you end up with so many species, like 20-something species of Sicarina spiders in Central Texas, and a dozen species of Steodesmus millipede, like, yeah, seven species of these Tartaric rheagrus pseudoscorpions in the Austin area, some of which are, yeah, only found in, like, one little karst plateau island. So you have, like, half a square mile that's their entire range in the whole world. So it's pretty cool stuff.
It's just super fascinating. The next question, and we got a couple of people that asked similar versions of this question, but is, what can we do to protect this cave habitat for these organisms?
Well, what can you do? So if you don't want to kill cave crickets, please do not put ant bait outside, like using Amdro and stuff like that. These cave crickets come out of their cave and they harvest, they forage in the forest for hundreds of meters away from the cave entrance. And unfortunately, since we have so many caves in Austin, specifically in like South Austin, as well as like Northwest Austin, there ends up being like most of our caves in that area will have a bunch of houses within the cricket foraging range. So if people are putting pesticides out, or yeah, like ant baits and stuff like that, the crickets will come and eat them and die. There was a case where we had a cave and there was nearby soccer fields, and some of the people were putting ant baits out, and then we went to the cave and found thousands of dead cave crickets inside because they were eating the ant baits. So basically what you want to do is, yeah, try to not put out any kind of chemicals, because the chemicals will, if they're not just picked up by an organism, they'll also wash in the runoff and pour into the cave and contaminate the caves. So best to, yeah, not, if you could, yeah, xeriscape your lawn, things like that, not be using a bunch of fertilizers and everything. Those are a lot of the ways you can help protect these caves.
And this next question kind of ties into that, and I believe it's much of the same answer as far as like runoff pollution, but it's, how does the pollution of the karst waters affect your cave populations of the organisms?
Yeah, mostly for like, for the terrestrial troglodytic species, it probably doesn't affect them too much unless it was really bad pollution. But for these like stygobitic species and like the salamanders and stuff, they need like pristine water. If there's like any contamination at all, like oil runoff or pesticides or anything, I mean, they're like literally breathing the water. It's like absorbing into their skin and will kill them. And that's like another big misconception, is like everybody thinks like, oh, the soil is filtering everything. But when we get these big storms, it's just like pouring into a cave entrance unfiltered, and there's not like a strainer or anything. I mean, the cave is big enough that I can crawl through it, so if I can get through, so can all these other things, and it all goes straight into the aquifer. Basically no filtration. That is why, when as much as possible around cave entrances, you want to have a really big green area with natural vegetation, because it will at least slow down and absorb a bunch of the stuff into the soil, which will somewhat filter it, rather than if the area has been urban, covered in urban surfaces that are non-permeable, then all of it just washes super fast. And then once it hits soil, it rips up the soil and washes it all into the cave and can cause a big problem.
Awesome. Thank you for that. The next one came up when you were talking about the micro whip scorpions. Are they related to the species of above ground whip scorpions that you see in West Texas?
I'm sure they're distantly related, but yeah, I don't know. They're apparently found just in the soil around here. I mean, you'd be surprised. You can just go out into the woods around here, and if you collect a bunch of moist leaf litter, put it in this thing called a Berlizzi funnel, where it's like a metal funnel, and you put a light with a hole in the bottom, you put a light on the top, and it slowly dries out all the material. All these little creatures that live in the leaf litter and soil will fall out of the bottom into your jar, and you'll get micro whip scorpions, mites, all sorts of different species of springtails, little pseudo scorpions and stuff that are surface species. And so these are like basically a lot of these creatures end up by finding their way into caves, either getting washed in or just crawling down a crack next to some tree roots. And then when they end up and they're like, oh, it's nice here, it's like 100% humidity all the time, I think I'll stay. And so that's how we end up with a lot of these soil organisms down in the caves.
That's awesome. Okay, unless anyone has any other questions, we have one more here. We could end on a light note here. And I think you hinted at this during your talk, but what is your favorite karst invertebrate? I know it's hard to pin a biologist on their favorite critter, but what do you think?
Well, yeah, for my favorite's got to be the Tartaro creagris, just because they're so wicked looking with their giant pincers and they're covered in hairs and everything. So that's my favorite.
Awesome. Yeah, I have to say that the video that you showed of the springtail walking across the water without any, just looking like a sheet of glass, was just super cool. I'd never seen that before. It was just awesome.
That was probably my second favorite. It's hard to say.
Awesome. Well, that wraps up the questions that we have submitted. Colin, I just want to say thank you.